It's a pleasure to welcome back Bill Murphy from Gold Antitrust Committee. Got it. With Chris Powell, they're looking out for the gold market investors and watching for manipulation schemes. Welcome back, Bill Murphy.
Good to hear from you, Chris.
Good to talk to you. And, you know, I understand that you're feeling in better spirits today. The precious metals have caught a bid. Tell us what you see happening in the markets, please.
At least yesterday, back from the dead, they've been so comatose. And the 3% rise in silver that we had was in one day was totally negated. Gold's 3% rise was partially negated. But gold has a lot of support at down where it was a couple days ago. And it had that, you know, out-of-nowhere rally yesterday, and at least bring some life back into a moribund market. And if silver can get above 14 and a quarter, and it's pretty close today, then it'll negate this massive top that it just completed. And the top, which is the way things can happen, it turns into a bottom should it close above that level and then go from there.
We've also had the greenback working against us. It had a big breakout a few weeks ago. I think startled a lot of investors. It looked toppy, got some strength there. It looks like the Fed and policymakers, they want to keep raising rates into 2019. But at some point, don't you expect the markets to recognize, you know, there's only so many arrows in the Fed's quiver. At some point, they're going to run out of ammunition, and these markets are going to break free.
Well, absolutely. I mean, gold and silver are so cheap, especially silver, which is gold-silver ratio got up to 86. It's farcical, and you're artificially cheap, and at some point, all of this, what you're talking about, everything's going to be discounted, or already has been. I mean, we had zero interest rates years ago, and what did it do for gold and silver? Nothing, because of what I call the gold cartel and the suppression schemes. And at some point, these schemes have, you know, got to end. We've already, you know, really, the way I look at it, you know, 7 to 7.5 year bear markets. We're due for a big change in a very explosive way, I think.
Take a look at the FANG stocks. These are your high-flying techs, as most folks know, which basically involves Facebook, Amazon, of course Netflix, and Google, among a few others. They've really been suffering. That's not great news for any of us. I think it's indicative of at least sector rotation in U.S. equities. And, you know, obviously at some point, those funds are going to start looking for a little more realistic returns and safety. I think we've seen some of that. Also wanted to talk to you today about an interesting article comment from Alistair MacLeod over at Gold Money. Bank of England refused Venezuela 14 tons of its gold. This is an interesting precedent. It's the first I've seen that I can recall where they just denied a request for the return of your funds, repatriation. And here's their argument that I think is flimsy at best, concerned about money laundering. I would argue it's de facto shakiness within the ranks of the central bankers.
Well, I mean, what a horse manure excuse for not returning gold.
I mean, I don't trust you enough to give you back your gold.
It is just, what is interesting to me about that is for years we heard from some of our colleagues over in London how tight the gold market is. And quite frankly, that hasn't meant a thing year after year after year. And we hear about all these the gold that's leaving England and going here and going there and tightness and different backwardations, not great but small, and that it's going away. And this is the first indication of what these, you know, fine guys have been talking about is correct, and the bad guys, the gold cartel again, as I call it, could be hitting the wall. I mean, this takes it more out of the speculation area, more into the factual area, and that would be my reasoning for it. They're not giving it back because it's gone. And if trying to get, or at least getting what they have left, would create a problem. And so they come up with this silly excuse for not returning it to Venezuela.
Yeah, and let's investigate this term gone. You know, it has, I think, several different definitions here. I mean, firstly, gone can mean that it's there, but it's been rehypothecated so many times, nobody knows who owns what. Gone, I think, can mean come get your gold. We got the gold. We've got the guns. We're way up here in the northern hemisphere. You're way down there in the southern hemisphere. Maybe you should send your big Venezuelan fleet of naval cruisers to convince us to pick it up. This is an interesting scenario, but it's definitely at least looks like an endgame play. Nervousness, I think, and it's just indicative of overly anxious central bank regime that knows that the days are numbered, that there's something big coming, and they don't want to risk parting with said precious metal. Moving on here, the Spider Gold Trust, the largest gold-backed exchange fund, of course, seeing big flows out of riskier equity ETFs and markets into gold bullion. They had the highest peak now, 24 million ounces in their supposed stockpiles. I'd like your thoughts on what this might indicate, this trend.
You know, again, it really hasn't meant much. Was that as of, to the end of October?
That was actually end of August, so it's an earlier reading.
You know, we've gone into comatose trading, and it's been, you know, then we had the red till just yesterday. We're back in the weeds. We had silver and contract new low ground. It's good to see that coming, and I think that you're correct that the way these markets are trading and indications where other stocks, where GE may have a debt problem, and Goldman Sachs, a highly respected firm, of course, you know, their stock is in shambles, and Apple, as concern is all of a sudden perhaps beginning to really grow in terms of investments. You know, every correction we've had in the stock market for, what, 10 years, it always goes right back up, complacent, and understandably so. But recently, that's starting to get, you know, shaken up a bit, and what you're talking about here could really pick up steam, and if it could really be quite something if, in fact, getting back to the gone principle of the gold, that all of a sudden everybody wants it when nobody wanted it, you know, till recently, and then it's having trouble, you know, getting it. So that's where I think our next move up is going to be explosive. It won't be a gradual one like we saw for the first 12 years part of this decade. I mean, it's going to be something very special, I think.
Yeah, it's interesting you'd bring up GE because this, of course, one of the last remaining key components of what was essentially the original Dow Jones Industrials, you know, the composite there. It looks to me like it's ready to be kicked out of the blue chip status because take a look at the chart. I mean, you're looking at a company that was trading $25 to $30 just a year or so ago, entered a death spiral down last check around $7 or $8, which means it's probably now a pretty good buy. But, I mean, that's not the type of thing we advise folks to do here, look catching falling knives. One of the key blue chips, and it obviously is about ready to be kicked out of the Dow. One of the greatest technological behemoths of all time, redefining, you know, the modern electronic age, General Electric, gone. Do you want to put all your eggs in that type of basket? Keeping with our FANG stock original thesis, big fans of Netflix, NVIDIA, and many others. However, let's not bet the farm. Make sure we've got at least 20% in the yellow metal and silver. And when it's on discount like this, you know, you can maybe take a little speculative risk because the return to the mean could be pretty spectacular here. Tell us how we might return to the mean.
In my terms of looking at things, I mean, silver is the cheapest asset in the world. I mean, the fact is it's collapsed from, you know, 50 to 14. I mean, that is just mind-boggling in the past number of years. And it's here was that was the price that we had in 1980. So it is, I think, going to be absolutely a spectacular investment when it you know, gets through 21, which I've mentioned many times. Of course, first it's got to get through 15. And gold, I mean, it's, you know, at trading, you know, above, you know, 1,200 for crying out loud. After all that's been done, we've talked about that many times. It is so undervalued, and when it gets going, it's going to be, you know, spectacular. I think, you know, you've heard me say this before, but I'm a Newton's law fan of equal and opposite reactions. Talking about returning to the mean, but I think as bad as gold and silver have been these last number of years, they will be that much better on the upside.
I mean, we might even defy gravity here, break not only Newton's but Einstein's laws of physics. And one of the interesting components that might just help propel, I think, such an event could be this overlooked concept of inflationary tax burdens. And what do I mean exactly? Well, let's talk about the tariffs. We've talked about in the past here how the tariffs on Canadian lumber have already increased or inflated the price of new homes here domestically approximately 9 to 10% on just one tariff. Tell me that's not inflationary. Of course, from the Austrian perspective, it's not because it doesn't impact the money supply. But, you know, from the more Keynesian and monetarist viewpoint, it's inflationary because it impacts prices directly. So any way you want to slice it, I mean, prices are going up. prices go up for lumber, prices go up for key resources, then there are other key resources in manufacturing, such as silver. You know, the most underloved, the most three standard deviations to the downside of the precious metals. What's to stop something from occurring in the silver market, Bill Murphy, similar to palladium, precious metal trading at $100 or $200, and before you know it, it's nearly at parity with gold? And the argument is, the case is, well, it's just really useful in catalytic converters, and there's been tremendous auto sales, people front-running the tariffs around the world. Maybe that's the case. Do you see a sort of wake-up moment where silver catches fire, just like palladium?
Exactly. That's what I was talking about. Once it gets above, in my opinion, 21, I've been looking for $100 silver now. It couldn't be more off base for a year or two or more. But I think it's going to, what you're talking about is exactly what's going to happen. That's how silver is going to trade. It's going to go bonkers once it's all cleaned out and the J.P. Morgan crowd is forced to retreat or just stops what they're doing. And it's going to be something. And, of course, it could go much higher than 100, but for right now, 100 looks pretty good to me.
Hey, that's the key takeaway for today's show. Silver goes bonkers, triple digits at least. Bill Murphy at Gotta.org. Can you tell us a bit more about Gotta.org and La Metropole Cafe, please?
My colleague Chris Powell does a great job. We just had a lot of fun in New Orleans and seen a lot of good people. And they can get on his list at www.gotta.org. And Chris does a great job there. And I've been doing La Metropole Cafe now for 20 years, and people can sign up for a 2-week free trial and see if it is of interest.
Bill Murphy, thank you.
Good to hear from you, Chris.